Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So all the women who are watching me out there, a very happy Women's Day to all of you. So women, break the bias. Yes, this is the time for all of us to break the bias, whether it is in the field of professionalism, whether it is in the field of personal life. Okay, this is not the something that I am saying. This is something that Indian government has said. So the campaign that the government is running on this day is hashtag break the bias. Whereas the theme of today's day is gender equality today for a sustainable tomorrow. So both of these themes are really easy and very meaningful in our lives. If we want to achieve a sustainable tomorrow, we need to have a gender equal society, not a gender equal only society, but equality is needed in every sense, be it race, caste, creed, gender or anything. Okay, but since today we are specifically focused on the gender equality, so we will talk about that only. So let's begin today's current affairs, which will definitely have one question from the events that are organized as part of the iconic week. Now what is it that you will discover when you see the video completely? Okay, so let's move into the video. So guys, the very first question that we have is, where was India's first fully equipped mobile ambulance for street animals launched? So here Chennai guys is the right answer. Now Blue Cross for India and Four Paws, these two organizations have launched this first mobile ambulance for the treatment of the street animals, okay, in Chennai. And remember, it is India's first such ambulance. Next question is, which organization is partnering DST, that is Department of Science and Technology, working under the Ministry of Science and Technology, in its Building AI Readiness Among Young Innovators program? Sorry guys, my throat is a little sore today. So the right answer here is option E, Intel. Intel has partnered with the Department of Science and Technology to launch this program. Now, very evidently from its name itself, it is conveying the purpose of this program, that is to encourage the young people to create awareness among the young people regarding the applications of artificial intelligence. But who will decide which young people will be applicable under this program? So the students who are studying in class 6 to 10th are eligible for this program, and not all the students. There is also another eligibility criteria. So that criteria is that the students who are enrolled under this scheme of Department of Science and Technology will get the benefit of this program, which has been launched with Intel. Okay, so what this scheme is, what this entire program is, now let's go into that only. So guys, I have already told you the purpose of this program, that is to acquaint the young children, that is the students of 6th to 10th, with the AI applications. Okay, but it was launched on a special day, that is National Science Day, that was celebrated on February 28th. You need to tell me the theme of this day, okay, in the comment section below. Now apart from this, another thing from this news is that it will be launched in three different phases across the country. However, it is a very non-significant statement, I would say, but still the number is important. You need to know three phases would be there of this campaign. Now the eligibility criteria, which I have already informed you about, that is that the students need to be a part of this scheme. Now what is this scheme? First of all, Inspire in itself, it has a full form, which is innovation in science pursuit for inspired research. Okay, these kinds of full forms are important for you to memorize. Now guys, this is in itself a full-fledged scheme, and under this scheme a sub component, we can say, or we can say a sub scheme was launched, which was named as Manak, Million Minds Augmenting National Aspiration and Knowledge. So basically under this scheme, Inspire awards Manak. Under this full scheme, the government tries to encourage the students, again the students who are studying in class to 10th, okay, So those students are encouraged, but in what field are they encouraged? They are encouraged in the field of science and technology. The students who give innovative ideas that have a societal application as well, these people, these students are awarded by the Department of Science and Technology under this scheme, which is named as Inspire Awards Manak Scheme. Okay, so I hope that now this scheme is clear to you. And the target of this scheme, Inspire Awards Manak, is to encourage or recognize at least 1 million original ideas and innovations given by the school children. Okay, so that is the entire news all about. Now let's move on to the next question. On which highway is India's first green charging station being built? Okay, so guys, it is Jaipur to Agra. Jaipur, Delhi, Agra. Now, why is it the first green electric vehicle station? First of all, understand this thing, that every electric vehicle station is going to give the electricity for charging the e-vehicles, which are themselves are of green nature. They are going to boost the green environment. Okay, so is that the explanation of this green station? No, guys. So here, this station is considered as India's first green station because, first of all, the technology which is used in the construction of this station is green and sustainable in nature. Okay, all the construction technologies which are sustainable in nature that will be used for developing the station, okay, that will be built along the Jaipur Delhi Agra highway. Secondly, the electricity that will be produced in this station, that will also be sourced from the solar power plants. Okay, so rooftop solar panels will be installed at this station, and through that, those panels electricity will be generated. Then that electricity will be supplied to the EVs, and in this manner a circular virtuous circle of renewable energy will be created. And this, in this manner, we can say that it is truly a green electric vehicle charging station. And remember, it is first in India. Okay, so all that I taught you is written here, which you can read on your own. Remember, guys, you will get the PDF of this session on the Telegram channel, and the link of our Telegram channel is in description below. So guys, the next question that we have is, which of the following organization has developed Kavach automatic train protection system? Guys, first of all, the very important part about Kavach is that it is indigenously developed. Okay, so we have one major authority that has developed it, and that authority is Research, Design and Standards Authority of Indian Railways. So it has developed this technology in partnership with the private industries of India. Okay, now it is considered as the world's cheapest train collision avoidance technology that has been developed by India only. Okay, so that is the peculiarity of this Kavach system. Apart from this, the recent testing of it was held at Hyderabad. So guys, this is another minute fact that you can cover from this news. So apart from this, there is nothing much in this news. Moving ahead, so now this is the question of the International Women's Day. So which ministry has announced to conduct the town hall meeting on the occasion of International Women's Day week celebrations? So you must know that from March 1st to March 8th, India celebrated the iconic week, and that iconic week is specifically for the International Women's Day celebration in India. And I have already told you the campaign that is being run in India, that is Break the Bias. Okay, and the UN theme is Gender Equality Today for a Sustainable Tomorrow. Now guys, there is a ministry that has conducted this town hall meeting with the women working in the ministry itself, women working in various departments, women working in Northeastern Council also. So now, what is the answer? I hope that it is easy to guess now. It is option C, Ministry of Development of the Northeastern Region. So this ministry has conducted this meeting, and there is nothing much in this meeting. So far, we already have a Stri Manoraksha project launched by the Ministry of Women and Child Development in order to provide the mental guidance to the one-stop centers. Okay, your task is to tell me the number of beneficiaries that are covered under the Stri Manoraksha project, which I covered just few days back. So tell me in the comment section below. Next question is, which of the following city hosted the India Global Forum? So guys, here Bangalore is the right answer. So this is basically a platform. Okay, this event acts as a platform for the leaders and for the companies, okay, global companies also. So they come together, they discuss their common issues and they try to come up at a solution during this forum so that they can have a better environment for working. Okay, so business environment ko bhi boost milta hai through this India Global Forum, which is organized in Bangalore this year. So apart from this, there is nothing else in this news. Who is the Vice Chancellor of Delhi Teachers University? So since this university was recently inaugurated by Manish Sisodia in Delhi, that's why it was in the news. So who is the Vice Chancellor of this university? It is Dhananjay Joshi. Apart from this, since the name itself mentions the UT where it is located, so I don't think that they will ask you the location of this university. The max they can ask is the Vice Chancellor. Where is the Dudhala village, the first village to be completely solarized by Sri Ramakrishna Knowledge Foundation located? So guys, this village is located in Gujarat. Recently, we have the Goldie Solar Organization and Sri Ramakrishna Organization, Sri Ramakrishna Knowledge Foundation coming up together to solarize a village in southern Gujarat, and that village is Dudhala village. Now how will they solarize it? They will basically create a plant, they will use the rooftop installations to generate solar electricity, and then the households of this village will be provided electricity. Okay, so you don't have to mug up so many informations from this news. The major points here are the organizations that I have already highlighted and the name of the village, which is located in Gujarat, and at the most you can remember that it is in the southern Gujarat, the southern region of Gujarat. Okay, now it is the first village that is completely solarized by a foundation. So this is another fact. Apart from this, this is guys completely you can say an additional fact that has been given, which you can ignore right now. Next question is, which state is planning to set up a government-sponsored equity participation fund to invest in the fast-growing SMEs on the NSE's Emerge platform? Okay, so this platform is basically for the small and medium enterprises to encourage SMEs in India to list themselves and then raise funds. And for this purpose, NSE launched this Emerge platform. Right now, NSE has partnered with Telangana in order to encourage the SMEs located in the state to get themselves listed on this Emerge platform. At the same time, the Telangana government has also put forward its wish to create this kind of government-sponsored equity fund, okay, so that it can also invest in the SMEs. So it is just in the planning stage. Okay, the government of Telangana is planning to invest in the SMEs, and for that it is planning an equity fund. Okay, so guys, that is the complete news. Moving ahead to the next news, where was the sea level trial of Hansa NG aircraft conducted? So guys, NG stands for new generation, and this is basically an advanced version of the Hansa helicopter that was already there, aircraft that was already there. Okay, so where was the sea trial of this new helicopter was conducted? So it was in Puducherry. Okay, so guys, another fact from this news itself is that it was developed by the National Aerospace Laboratories. Okay, do remember the organization developing this Hansa NG aircraft. Now let me show you the picture of this aircraft. So this is guys the technology that has been developed by the CSIR NAL. Okay, moving ahead to the next question, which of the following auxiliary barge was launched by the Indian Coast Guard recently? So here guys, Urja Prabha is the right answer. Now let me show you what Urja Prabha is. So here you can clearly see it's a ship. Yes, it is a ship. So this auxiliary barge is nothing but a ship that provides logistic support to the ICJ ships that are in a far-flung area, that are already in the sea, okay, and located at a far-flung area. Okay, so ICJ is Indian Coast Guard. Your task is to tell me the director of Indian Coast Guard at present. in the comment section below. The next question is, which edition of Slynex will take place in 2022? So guys, it is the 9th edition. Slynex stands for Sri Lanka India Naval Exercise. Okay, so it is going to take place at Visakhapatnam. Next question is, which of the following country is not placed on the grey list of FATF? Okay, not is here. So you have Albania, Cayman Islands, Turkey, Mali, Indonesia. Out of these, Indonesia, guys, is the right answer. Indonesia is not on the FATF's grey list, okay? So recently, UAE has been put into the grey list, which may prove as a big shock to India as well. Why am I saying this? Because recently, India, UAE, Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement has been signed, and I hope that you have already covered it. We have covered it in the Spotlight magazine also. So what kind of products have got the exemption or reduced tariffs, that is all that is covered in the CEPA, Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement, that is Free Trade Agreement. Okay, UAE, guys, is the only country that has announced an investment of $100 billion in India's infrastructure, okay, in order to help India fulfill its 400 billion export target. Okay, next is that UAE is again the company, the country that has announced to invest 1000 crores in Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, so these are the recent news related to UAE, and now we have UAE in the grey list of FATF. Okay, so guys, this I have already told you, and this may impact its investment in India also. Now, why is a country put into the grey list? First of all, understand that grey list, guys, is basically a list into which when a country enters into the list, FATF increases its monitoring over that country. Okay, the reasons for which a country is added into the list is maybe it is money laundering activities, or the financing of terrorism. So these are the two major reasons for which a country is put into the grey list by FATF, that is Financial Action Task Force. Okay, so we have Pakistan and Turkey into the list. Apart from these countries, many more countries are there, which I am going to tell you about. First, know that Zimbabwe has been put out of that list. Okay, so it is the sole country that has got out of this list. Guys, grey list is a very common term. The professional term that is used by FATF is jurisdictions with strategic deficiencies. And guys, this is the list of the countries that are into this list. Here you can see FATF, here you can see Pakistan, you have Turkey, and many more countries are there, and Zimbabwe is the only country that has got out of it. Now here I have put certain facts related to FATF, out of which the most prominent facts are the year of establishment and the headquarters of FATF. So 1989 and Paris, okay? These two are the most important words here that you need to memorize. Otherwise, everything is very conceptual. You need to just understand what is the purpose of the FATF's grey list and what is the outcome of when a country enters into that list. Okay, so I have already told you the reason for which the country enters into the grey list and the outcome. That means FATF starts monitoring the financial transactions of that country. At the same time, FATF also prepares a plan, an action plan for the country to correct its financial transactions, to correct its ways. Okay, so that is all about this question. Now we have another question which is very interesting. So guys, the next question is, how much solar capacity was added in 2021 as per the 2021 Q4 annual India solar market update report of Mercom India Research? So guys, this is an important report and this is an important organization. So this organization basically releases reports on the solar energy and renewable energy of India, okay, the status of it. So according to this report, 10 gigawatt of solar energy was installed in 2021. And guys, this is the historic installation in just 1 year. Okay, so we can say in 2021, a lot of solar energy projects or new capacity was added in India. Now, this report has a lot to say. Now, let's know what are the other things that this report has put forward. So, guys, first of all, I have already told you 10 gigawatt is a record addition in the solar power capacity of India. And guys, this is an increment of 212 percentage points. Okay, in last year, in 2020, 3.2 gigawatt installation addition in the solar capacity. Okay, so this, guys, is the addition. Okay, so from this to this much, so in just 1 year, from 3.2 gigawatt of addition to 10 gigawatt of additions in just 1 year, this is an increment which, if you translate into percentage form, then it would be 212. Then we have the cumulative solar installed capacity. That means the total solar energy capacity that is there in India that is operational at present is 49 gigawatts. Okay, at the end of December 2021, guys, this is again an important statement. In 2021, 62% of the new power capacity additions were of solar power. Okay, so all the new projects that were started in 2021, particularly in the field of energy generation, out of those projects, 62% projects were of solar energy. Okay, so this is again an important statement that you can use in your ESI answers whenever you get any answer on India's efforts towards curbing the carbon emissions. Okay, so solar power is also one of the ways to curb the carbon emissions and to achieve our 2070 goal of carbon neutrality. Then, in terms of states, Rajasthan, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh were the top three states in terms of cumulative large scale solar capacity. Basically, the total solar power in terms of total solar installed capacity, Rajasthan, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh are the top three states. Whereas if we talk about the solar power capacity additions in 2021, then Rajasthan is at the top because it has added into its existing capacity 4.5 gigawatt of new solar energy, okay, in 2021. And renewable energy sources accounted for about 77% of new power capacity added into the 2021. Now, guys, understand this 77% is talking about the renewable power energy sources that may include your hydropower plants, your wind power plants, your nuclear power plants, etc. Okay, this is not only about solar, whereas 62% was only about solar. Okay, so I hope that this demarcation is clear. Still, if you have any kind of doubt coming up in your mind, please share it with me and I will resolve your doubt. So guys, this is the picture that I got from the report, and here you can clearly see the installations. Okay, large scale solar installations that are rising only. In 2020 only it has decreased because of the corona, but then it is rising. And this gray portion, guys, is the rooftop solar energy, okay, which you can see clearly is rising. Next is, guys, the most important part of this chart is this. Here you can see the installed power capacity mix of top states, okay, as of December 2021. So here you have Rajasthan. Now, guys, this gray portion, this portion is thermal. Then your this portion is nuclear, then your yellow portion is solar. So here you can see the increase in the solar power use and the overall renewable energy in these states. However, you don't have to memorize this entire chart. It is just for your information purpose. But yes, you need to know the top three states, Rajasthan, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. And if you can remember it, then you can remember at least top five states in solar power installed capacity. That is, next is Tamil Nadu and Gujarat. So here, guys, this report ends. Now we are going to move to the next question. When was the investments in non-SLR securities by primary urban cooperative banks circular released by RBI? So guys, it was released in 2009. Now what is the entire news? Recently, basically, RBI has exempted investments made by the urban cooperative banks in basically the investment that the urban cooperative banks make in the umbrella organizations, okay, from any kind of limits, okay. So earlier the non-statutory liquidity ratio securities limit was imposed, which was 10%, okay. So let me show you the limits only. So what was the situation earlier to this? Now all the limits have been exempted. Now the urban cooperative banks can freely subscribe to the capital of our umbrella organization. I will talk about the umbrella organization as well, but first know what was the earlier limit that has now been removed by RBI. So earlier limit says, according to the circular, that non-SLR investments will be limited to 10% of the bank's total deposits as of March 31st of the previous year, and also investments in unlisted securities shall not exceed 10% of the total non-SLR investments at any time. Okay, at any time. Now, what are the non-SLR investments? So, guys, these are the investments that are done in securitization or reconstruction companies. Okay, so all this was very technical. Okay, so from phase one point of view, you don't have to go into so much detail. So what can be asked from you is the earlier limit, because now the limit has been exempted. So earlier it was 10% of the total deposits of the urban cooperative banks. Now guys, what is the umbrella organization? So in 2019 only RBI has approved to create an umbrella organization, and the purpose of this umbrella organization was to provide help to small urban cooperative banks. Okay, what kind of help will be provided? First of all, liquidity management help will be provided. Okay, so the small urban cooperative banks which have excess funds, excess liquidity, they can park their funds with the umbrella organization, similar to what banks do with RBI. Okay, then if any UCB is facing any kind of shortage of funds, then it can borrow from the umbrella organization itself. Okay, so that is the very similar function that RBI performs for the banks as the lender of the last resort. Okay, so similar function would be provided by this umbrella organization. Apart from this, one more function will be provided, and that function is the IT services. Okay, so a cumulative, or we can say a centralized IT platform will be created by this umbrella bank, and through that platform, basically like you have the core banking solutions. Okay, so similar platform will be created by this umbrella organization, through which all the urban cooperative banks will get the access, and they can use the emerging technologies at a very low cost by becoming the members of this UO, okay, the umbrella organization. So this organization, National Federation of Urban Cooperative Banks and Credit Societies, had got the permission from RBI to create this umbrella organization. So I hope that this question is clear. Now the next question is, what is the location of Jio World Center? So guys, it is Bandra Kurla complex in Mumbai, and it is nothing but a kind of you can say big complex, like you have the mall, okay, but it is not exactly a mall. It is a complex that will have your business opportunities, that will have your stadiums, that will also have Dhirubhai Square also, okay. So all of these kinds of features will be there, and you need not to know all of these features. Just Bandra Kurla complex is important. That is something that can trick you in the examination. Next question is, what is the worth of exports sent by India to Canada during April to January 2021 to 2022? So guys, first of all, let me tell you the news about it. So basically, India and Canada, both of these countries have started their negotiations on free trade agreement. Okay, remember, you with UAE, India has already signed this, and with Israel, India is negotiating on the free trade agreement, and with Canada, it has now launched the negotiations. So in the wake of this news, or in the background of this news, the trade that happened between India and Canada during April to January 2022 is important. So here you have different figures, out of which, guys, some important figures are these. Like India's total exports to Canada was US dollar $3 billion, okay, which was 0.88% okay, of India's total exports. Then India's imports from Canada stood at $2.5 billion, which is 0.52% of India's total imports. Now guys, clearly you can see that we are having a surplus, okay, of 500 million or so. So in 2020 also, India had a trade surplus of nearly 200 million with Canada. These are some of the figures related to India-Canada trade. And now, because we have the FTA with Canada, the negotiations on that have been launched. So these figures can be asked from you. Okay, apart from this, what kind of products do we export to Canada? In majority are organic chemicals, pharmaceuticals, apparel, textile, iron and steel. And imports from Canada are vegetables and petrol products. Okay, so these are the major facts related to India-Canada trade. Next question is, who has been appointed as a chairperson of Telecom Dispute Settlement Appellate Tribunal? So guys, D.N. Patel is the right answer. When is the raising day of CISF celebrated? So guys, March 10 is the right answer. Who is the author of The Great Tech Game, Shaping Geopolitics and the Destiny of Nations book? So here Anirudh Suri is the right answer. So guys, here all the questions are done for the day. So I saw your comments in the yesterday's video where you were asking me about the newspapers. So guys, let me give you a list of newspapers that you can read for your RBSEPI and NABARD examination. So first of all is Mint. Okay, now I'm not giving you the list so you can read all, you can start read all the newspapers. No, just pick up one newspaper. I'm giving you the list. Pick up the newspaper which takes less of your time. Okay, the language of the newspaper, pick the newspaper whose language is easy to understand. Okay, for you. Then we have The Hindu. Then we have Indian Express. I would not recommend Economic Times to you all because Economic Times consumes a lot of time. It has a lot of news, okay? Even this much of space has certain news in it. So that would be of no use for you because we prepare the Spotlight magazine in order to reduce your time. And I'm giving you the list of newspapers so that you can develop understanding regarding the concepts that are there in the world, okay? So I have given you the list of Mint, Hindu, Indian Express, and apart from this, I don't think that Hindustan Times is also a good newspaper, but I won't recommend it specifically, okay? The major focus would be on these three newspapers, Mint, Hindu, and Indian Express. You can pick up any one of these, okay? Mint is of utmost importance because you are a banking aspirant, okay? If you are an aspirant of UPSC, then you can use Hindu or Indian Express, any of these. Okay, so I hope that this much is clear. And now I'm going to bid adieu to you all. Thank you so much for watching this session.